Good morning, everyone. At the outset, I would like to thank the organizers, especially Dr. Pushpa Somonshi ma'am, Dr. Pranjal, and so many seniors I'm finding sitting here. So I'd be very happy to deliver this talk, which is so important as a part of obstetric emergency. So in your labor room, you receive this patient, 35 years old, grand multipara, delivered at home, placenta also removed at home by a dai, brought to labor ward with profuse bleeding. Her pulse rate is 120 per minute, blood pressure 90 by 50 millimeter of mercury, bright red bogey mass at the perineum with profuse bleeding PV. Postpartum hemorrhage with a fleshy mass at perineum. You will have 2-3 differential diagnosis. Some mass hanging at the introitus or at the perineum. So naturally, first and foremost which comes to your mind is inversion of uterus. Second, prolapse of uterine tumor. A very large endometrial polyp sometimes which may just prolapse out, and uterine rupture. Sometimes the whole of placenta is delivered, but you have a succinctured lobe of placenta. So you have this patient coming to you at the labor ward. So how do you go ahead with this? How do you manage this patient? So first and foremost, what is inversion? Inversion is nothing but turning inside out. The fundus, which is there at the top, the inner aspect turns down and starts coming down. So when only the fundus descends into the uterine cavity, but it does not cross beyond the cervix, so that is grade 1 or incomplete inversion. When it crosses beyond the cervix and comes out of the cervix or even comes out of the introitus, then it is called as complete inversion. Just to make you understand by diagrammatic representation, first degree is the fundus just inverts, it starts descending down through the body of uterus or the uterine cavity, but does not cross the cervix. Second, it crosses the cervix but does not cross the vagina. And third, it comes out of the introitus. So that is complete inversion. So just to understand, we have what is called as acute and what is chronic inversion. So this is just in relation to time. If the inversion occurs immediately within first 24 hours, then it is acute. If between 24 hours to 4 weeks, then it is subacute. And if after 4 weeks, then it is chronic inversion. Now, all of you deliver so many patients, remove so many placenta. Why only some patients land up into uterine inversion? Why only some people may face this problem? So there are certain factors which are inherent or natural, and there are certain factors which are aggravating factors. So first two basic factors are fundal insertion of the placenta, especially the placenta which is inserted at the fundus, and it is morbidly adherent. It is morbidly adherent. Secondly, atonicity of the uterus. So these are the inherent or natural factors. But what are the factors or what are your actions which can lead to the precipitation? The first and foremost is your unnecessary traction on the cord. And second, the uterine atonicity which is not maintained properly. And third, of course, the improper traction, as we have said already, that is improper management of third stage of labor. So what is the proper management of third stage of labor? How do you manage this patient? So before that, we should know what are the findings. How do you diagnose? I know all of you, after delivering the placenta, you all see and palpate the fundus of the uterus. See to it that it is very hard, contracted and well retracted. But then when you start finding the uterus, start palpating the uterus, you don't find the uterus palpable. So that is a suspicion that yes, there can be uterine inversion. If you examine the patient, she has bleeding per vaginam, which may be profuse, and you find a red fleshy mass at the vagina. So what is the management of this condition? Management for any condition for that matter is prevention. As you all know, prevention is better than cure. So management should start right at the prevention. You have to do active management of third stage of labor, but the placental removal has to be by Brand Andrews technique. Not only Brand Andrews technique, you have to see that the placenta is separated first. So what are the signs of placental separation? You get a feeling of crepiness, crepitus at the suprapubic region. You have apparent lengthening of the cord and you have a fresh gush of blood. So that is how there are signs of separation of placenta, and this is a time where you should give traction. So giving traction on the cord, at the same time giving counter traction on the fundus, not fundal pressure, it is counter traction. So that is how you can prevent the uterine inversion. Once you diagnose the uterine inversion, what you are supposed to do is you have to push it as soon as possible. If once you diagnose the uterine inversion, you have to try and replace it as soon as possible. But at the same time, because this is a very catastrophic condition, once it progresses, it can lead to maternal mortality. So you have to see that you call for help. Some people say you shout for help, but for what? You have to call additional staff of your hospital, additional obstetrician who may be senior and experienced or may be junior but expert in this obstetric emergencies. Then you have to call the anesthetist, you have to call the physician and the whole team of blood bank. You have to send the investigations as well. Start putting two IV lines at the earliest with 18 gauge intercath. Start IV fluids fast, crystalloids as we always say that, and you start arrangement of blood. At the same time, you are supposed to manage the inversion as soon as possible. So as I have said initially, that you are supposed to do manual correction. So what is manual correction? You have to put a high level disinfector glove, catch hold of the fundus which is hanging down, and you are supposed to push it gently inside towards its normal position. But doing this, the part which comes last is supposed to be replaced first. That means this is fundus and this is the base. So base you will push first and then the fundus. You will push it towards umbilicus. With the other hand, you will stabilize this uterus. You will keep this hand for some time inside the uterus. Give adequate oxytocin. Maintain the tone of the uterus. And then when you are sure that everything is fine, you will remove your hand gently. You will maintain the oxytocin for at least 6 to 8 hours. Because this is a condition which has occurred because of atonicity of the uterus, and this may likely to recur. So that is the reason you are supposed to maintain the tonicity of the uterus. So next, suppose your manual correction fails, then what is the next procedure? You have something called as hydrostatic correction. So what is this hydrostatic correction? You are supposed to prepare a douche which is high level disinfected warm saline or water, which is a container of 3 to 5 liters with a long tubing of 2 meters maybe. You are supposed to adjust to the patient's vagina introitus, and you are supposed to have the long wide nozzle. Now when you are doing this procedure, what you are supposed to do, you are supposed to give a deep Trendelenburg position to the patient. That means head low. The head should be at least half meter lower than the perineum, like this, so that whatever fluid you push inside will create a pressure. So you are supposed to put the nozzle of that tubing in the posterior fornix. Now when you have partial inversion, it is very easy that you can palpate the fornix because you have some space. But when it is complete inversion, there is no fornix. So when you trace the vaginal rugosity and there is loss of rugosity, that is smoothness, that is a place you are supposed to keep the nozzle. You keep the nozzle with one hand, with other hand you seal the labia minora, ask your assistant to start the fluid warm saline with the pressure, and because of this head low position, it's going to create pressure inside that is going to push the uterine fundus up. So this is hydrostatic pressure. Once again, maintain the uterine tonicity and everything is the same. Now if this doesn't help, then what next? What you are supposed to do is, you are supposed to do surgical management. So this is a very simple method. You are having a fundus like this, the balloon inside out. So when you are doing laparotomy, you are opening by midline incision, pushing the bowel back, you're holding the uterus, but you are supposed to keep your hands like this, anterior and posterior in the lower segment, and inside you feel the inverted uterus. So you push it like this, you push it whatever part has inverted, and then it comes up. You're supposed to maintain it with uterine oxytocin. Now what is called as Huntington's operation, suppose this doesn't help, then if you with your hands you cannot do it, you are supposed to do hold it with Ellis or Babcock's forceps. You pull one part, pull slightly with hand, you advance your, so like this, you go ahead and you pull it, pull the whole thing. So this is Huntington's procedure. At the same time you have a second option, that is you put in a catheter in the dimple of the fundus. You inflate the balloon or you use Ventus vacuum cuff, pull it with the vacuum. So that dimple, you attach the vacuum to it, create pressure and you pull it. So that is how you can do it. The next procedure is what is called as Holton's procedure. Here what is done, you know, if the time lapses, the cervix becomes constricted. So what you are supposed to do, give a nick incise the posterior cervical ring from inside. You make it relax and now you have adequate space. You can pull the fundus up and then you suture whatever you have cut already. See, this is how it is. The posterior aspect of the cervix is cut, the fundus is delivered, and then. So just to complete the list, now I have these only three vaginal root procedures. Spinalis, that is give anterior incision from below and push the fundus above. Krishna's is posterior incision on the cervix and push the fundus. But if the time has lapsed, then you may land up into very severe hypoxia or ischemia of the uterus, and by the time maybe the patient's condition may be critical, so you may have to go for hysterectomy. So naturally we have to see that all these procedure, all these investigations and all the managements have to be done very fast, immediately and simultaneously. Of course, we have to see to it that we maintain the post-operative management properly. So that is how, in short, I have put in front of you the acute management of acute uterine inversion. So I feel I have done justice to this topic within this short time. So thank you so much for your patient listening. Thank you very much.